witness after witness called by the congressman to the podium, and they repeatedly said, well, we don't have any direct information. We simply don't know. So the situation was that now we had 15 million Americans using a product that we had no idea about the safety of. This was a huge political problem, and the cell phone industry acted politically to avert disaster. Because if the solution to this political problem was for the FDA to regulate cell phones, the cell phone industry would not have been able to be in compliance, and that industry would have been stopped dead in its tracks. So the head of the other trade association in the wireless industry, the CTIA, a fellow by the name of Tom Wheeler, made a deal with the regulatory agencies and the Congress. And the deal was something like this. Since there are no studies that say there's danger, and since there are no studies that say there isn't danger, we will put up $15 to $25 million to study the problem so long as you do not regulate us. So that deal was struck. And of course, it was a deal that in many ways was made in heaven for all parties, because the FDA now had a way of getting off the hook, because after all, they had given the industry a pass in 1984, so that there were 15 million Americans who could be pretty upset with the FDA for giving them a pass. Of course, the congressmen and the senators, this was a good deal for them as well, because now they had the ability to be seen as causing a solution to the problem. The industry is now going to put $15 to $25 million into a pot that didn't exist before. It looked like politically the system was working. And of course, the industry got the opportunity to have a pass for several more years while this 3 to 5 year program was put in place.
Mm-hmm. And it sounds like this is where you come into the picture. Is that right?
Well, it is where I came into the picture, and it was sort of an odd way that I found my way into this, because I had never done any work with regard to radiation prior to this. I'd been in Washington for several years, but most of my work had to do with things like environmental contaminants such as dioxin and pesticides and air pollution, silicone breast implants, other public health problems like that. And what had happened was when the issue was put before the Food and Drug Administration, there were several officials within the FDA who owned AT&T stock. And because they owned AT&T stock, they had to recuse themselves from this issue. And this, of course, was a political problem. And having been in Washington at the time for a decade or so, I got a call, and they said, this is a problem, and you may be able to help us with this. So I was asked to go over and sit down with the people at the trade association by the FDA. So the FDA actually asked me to go and sit down with the cell phone industry and to see if I could help them with a solution. And what we did was lay out an outline for them. And again, having the target agency being the Food and Drug Administration, we set up a program that would allow the cell phone industry to get back into compliance with the regulatory framework that the FDA had laid out, so that there would have been pre-market testing and post-market surveillance. In other words, pre-market testing before the product went into the market, and then post-market surveillance after the product is in the market to see what types of adverse reactions people have to using the product. So that the program put in place would have identified what studies needed to be done to fill the void in pre-market testing and put in place post-market surveillance. I gave them the program, and then went about my other business, and a month later they called me and they said, we haven't really been able to find anybody else who understands the breadth and depth of how to implement this thing. How about if you do it? And I had other work going at the time, but because I was being encouraged by my friends at the Food and Drug Administration to get involved in this, I made adjustments and took on the project. We set up a separate institute, if you will, called Wireless Technology Research to do this work, and we set up a trust fund, and the what ultimately became $28.5 million went into the trust fund, and the fund was used to fund more than 56 studies involving in vitro experiments, which in test tubes and petri dishes, exposure experiments, in vivo experiments in animals, and epidemiological studies in humans. So we covered the full panoply of the type of work that is normally done in pre-market testing and post-market surveillance. Now, the other thing that we did, Dr. Catherine, was at the time, since this program was being run by the Food and Drug Administration, or by the industry at the request of the Food and Drug Administration, we were concerned that at the end of it, if we didn't find anything, the media and consumers would simply say that the industry bought the result they wanted with the $28 million.
Uh-huh.
So in order to avoid that, we made sure that there were several layers of peer review. All of the studies done had to follow good laboratory practices, good clinical practices, and good epidemiology practices. Everything was done in the light of day, complete open books on the protocols, complete open books on the results, and we brought in the Harvard Center for Risk Analysis at the Harvard School of Public Health to put together an independent peer review board of doctors and scientists from around the world to oversee our work at every step.
Well, tell us, what did you and your team find after all of this due diligence?
Well, after all of this, and over a period of 5.5 years, we were absolutely shocked to find what we found. In the first instance, we had evidence that the radio frequency radiation opened up the blood-brain barrier. Now, let me explain a little bit what the blood-brain barrier is. See, brain tissue is highly specialized. All it does is think. And it doesn't have the ability to protect itself from any type of danger. And that is why we have, over time, evolved a thick skull to protect brain tissue from trauma. Also, in the vasculature, or blood vessels in the brain, there's a special filtering system called the blood-brain barrier. What the blood-brain barrier does is keep dangerous chemicals that are circulating in our blood is very toxic, from reaching the sensitive brain tissue. What we found was that exposure to the radio frequency radiation coming from the cell phone antenna opened up the blood-brain barrier and made that sensitive brain tissue vulnerable to those toxic chemicals circulating in the blood. This was a real surprise to us because up until this time, the only effects that had been shown related to radio frequency radiation were heating effects.